Hello friends, welcome to another episode of Techie Tuesdays. I'm your host and coach, Ezra Kumar. Techie Tuesdays is a weekly show where I answer to your tech and career related queries. So if you like my answers, then please subscribe to my channel and share this video with your friends, family and colleagues. So without further ado, let's get started with today's questions. So today's first question is asked by Siddharth Panchal. He is asking, which IT software companies are more successful, product-based or service-based? Siddharth, the answer to this is a bit tricky because it depends on what is the criteria of success you are keeping. Siddharth, it's a bit tricky to answer this question because the criteria of success differ from different companies to different company and different people to different people. If I talk about revenue and earnings potential, so in India, if I check for top 10 IT companies, I see most of the companies are either service-based company or productized service-based company. Remember, Microsoft is not just a product company, it also a productized service-based company. Same is the case with Amazon as well as Google. None of them are just product companies, all of them are product and productized service companies. But if we talk about just India, then as per the top 10 IT companies list, there is TCS, Infosys, HCL Technologies, Wipro Limited, Tech Mahindra, Redington, Larsen & Toubro. So all of these are basically service-based companies. So if you talk about India, in India, most of the successful companies are basically service-based companies. Next question is from Vimal. He is asking, should I have to keep learning even after getting a job? Vimal, whether it is a private job or a public job or a consultant job, in any job you have to keep learning till you die. So if you have to grow, then you have to keep learning. In life, it's a simple funda that if you have to grow, then you have to keep learning. If you don't keep learning, you become stagnant and your growth stops. As simple as that. So yes, you have to keep on learning even after getting job. Next question is by Jamin Tandale. He's asking, what is the difference between error, bug, defects, fault and failure? Jamin, let me answer one by one. Error is what happens when you are doing development. So during the development, if you get any kind of error in your code, that is called as error. So while coding, when you write something, if there is like the syntax is wrong, so that is syntax error. If at the runtime it doesn't work or it gives miss result, so then it most of time it's runtime error, or any exception happens, so that is again an error. Okay, so while doing, when you do any mistake, that is basically an error for a developer, I can say. Defects are basically again named to the problems which are found by a tester or even by customer also. It depends on which environment you have found out. So if the defects are on the testing environments found by tester, then it's a testing defects, or if they come on the production environment, so then they are called as production defects. So defects are those which are found by either tester or it's found on some environments. It's not during the process of development, it's after the development when it is deployed on it. Bug is basically a defect which is accepted by the developer that yes, he has done this mistake. So bug is when you haven't you have done some mistake or you have done some error which you haven't found out during the course of development, some kind of functional error or some kind of requirement you have missed. So that is called as bug, because it is like you have accepted that yes, you haven't identified it, and it's primarily in case of production environments. This is counted mostly in case of production environment, when the application goes on production environment and there you accept that okay, these are known bugs of this application. So that is basically a bug. So bug is an accepted defect. Fault is primarily used for hardware terms. So if suddenly the electricity goes out and there is no backup, so you can say that there is fault in the backup system, or like if the backup doesn't comes up, or the hard disk crashes, so you can say that there is fault in the hardware, like hard disk. So fault is basically used in terms of hardware systems. And failure is primarily used when the software doesn't meet any of its requirements. So it usually very rarely happens, but usually if the application or the software doesn't meet the requirement which was expected by the client or by the product owners, so in that scenario they say that okay, this product was a failure, so this kind of software was a failure. So failure is a pretty big word, and it happens very rarely, but failure is when your product doesn't meet your requirement. Next question is from Veena Madhuri. She is asking, how should I become a software engineer? I don't know where to start. Can you suggest a complete course or the best website to get a job as a software engineer? Veena, for becoming a software engineer in India, you need to do some computer related degree. So you have to either do BTech, or you have to either do BSc in computer science, or you have to do BCA, MCA. So you need to do some computer related degree in order to become a software engineer. Without a computer related degree, it's very tough to get opportunities in companies. That is number one. Number two, when we talk about sites, most of the sites are basically for upskilling yourself. There is no site which give you one end-to-end plan that okay, yes, you after completing this thing from our site, you can become a software developer. Sites are mainly for upskilling. There are sites like Udemy, there are sites like Pluralsight, there are sites like Coursera. So there are sites like Upgrad. Okay, so there are many sites. Some of the sites also provide degrees. So yes, you can go for those sites also, but they cost you almost as a college degree. So it's your choice. But yes, there are sites which provide degrees also. So you can go for those sites. So without doing any full-fledged degree, you won't be able to get a software engineer job. Next question is from Dhanush J. He is asking, suppose a person learns web development and software development on her own in India, is he she legally allowed to start freelancing through their skills? Dhanush, yes, you are legally allowed to work as a freelancer. But the problem is that you get very less jobs or very less tasks when you work as a freelancer and you don't have any computer related degree or computer related certification. So if you don't have a degree, no problems. For freelancer job, even if you have some certifications, then also it will work. So let's say if you are talking about Microsoft technology, so if you have Microsoft certified technology specialist certification in the technologies in which you are developing applications, then that will also work for getting freelancing works. Along with that, you need to create kind of a portfolio where what you have done, if you haven't done anything earlier, you don't have any experience, then you can create some sample projects to showcase your capability that yes, you know how to develop an application and these kind of applications you have developed. So you have to showcase those things, then only you will be able to get job. Legally, yes, you can do any kind of freelancing work related to computer or development even without having a degree, but for getting a work, you need to have some kind of certification or degree or experience. Next question is from Jagdeshwar. He is asking, I am interested in learning programming like Python, but don't want to work in a software job. What should I do? Jagdeshwar, why do you want to learn programming? Or why do you want to learn Python if you don't want to do a software job? So first find out why do you want to learn something. Like why do you want to learn programming? Find out your why and see that where that thing can be applicable. You may not work as a software developer or you don't want to do a software job, but if you are learning Python, which is a programming language, again it is a software related thing. So what do you want to do? Maybe you want to create a product, But again, that would be not a job, but yes, it's a kind of software related business. So yes, you have to find out what is your why you want to learn a particular programming language, and then you can go ahead with doing whether a job or a business. That's your choice. Next question is from Bhaskar Thapa. He's asking, what will be the best side business ideas for a software developer? Initially, when he asked this question, his question was, what will be the best side projects for a software developer? But then he got greedy and he need to know that what kind of side business he can do. So that's why he asked this question, that what will be the best side business ideas for a software developer. So Bhaskar, to answer your question, you can't do any kind of side business when you are working as a full-time software developer in a company. That's full and final. So at least in India, you can't do any kind of side business. So the best option for you would be to write blogs, contribute to community by contributing to open source projects. So you can do these kind of things. By doing these kind of things, you will build your personal technology brand, and it will help you in grow in your career as well as in getting future jobs. And this also answers to your question related what kind of side projects you can develop as a software developer. My suggestion won't be to develop any side project, because whenever we develop any side project or whenever we are working on any side project, the idea is to earn money, or we think that okay, we have to earn money. Otherwise, if we think that we have to learn something, we usually end up developing what is what is taught in the course of that new learning software or language or framework. Okay, so the better option is to contribute to open source. So let's say you want to learn something new, you better learn something like, let's say you are learning something about Blazor. Okay, so my suggestion for you would be to once you learn Blazor, instead of developing an application, contribute to any library which is already there for developing Blazor application. So there are many open source Blazor UI libraries to which you can contribute, either in form of documentation or in form of controls. So you can contribute to these things. It will not only help you in gaining credibility related to that technology, along with that, it will also help you in creating a community or participating in a community. So you will be kind of recognized in a community as a community developer, that yes, you are supporting the community. So that would be much more better option rather than creating a side project which will be of no use after some time, because you won't be able to publish it, you won't be able to earn money out of it, and you will only sulk that okay, I wasted my time developing this thing. Next question is from Manoranjan Gope. He's asking, can I mention the project name which I have done in my company, in my profile on Upwork, Freelancer, or any other freelancing sites? Manoranjan, first of all, you can't do any kind of freelancing work when you are already working in a company. So check with your HR first before creating a profile on Upwork, Freelancer, or any other freelancing site. If you are still working in a company, that do they allow freelancing or not while you are working in the company? Now coming to answer your question, no, you can't mention the projects which you have worked in your company in your profile on Upwork or Freelancer, because I don't think that companies allow to mention their client name or their product names in anywhere else apart from their own company documents. That's why you have confidential written on all the BRD, MRDs of the company, like project which you are working. So you can't name the project. However, what you can do is you can mention the project in a cryptic way. For example, you can mention the domain of the project. Like you can write that, okay, I created a project in travel domain for a Fortune 500 company. Okay, or you can write that I have created a application in finance domain, end-to-end application in finance domain for a startup. So you can write these kind of things, but you can't write the actual project name or the name of the client, because most of the companies prohibit that thing. So you need to again, but you need to check with your HR first. Next question is from Yashraj Singh Rathore. He's asking, is GitHub only for software engineers? Yashraj, no. GitHub is not just only for software engineers. It's also used for product development companies, component vendors, or open source project creators. So basically, GitHub is a version control system. So if you don't know what is a version control system, I'll give the link to my video where I have explained in both English as well as Hindi that what is a version control system. So GitHub is basically implementation of a popular version control system engine, that is Git. So GitHub can be used by anyone who wants to maintain versions of their documents. So it can not only be used for code, it also can be used for documents, or nowadays even GitHub is used for CI/CD because there is a feature called GitHub Actions, which is used for creating continuous integration or continuous deployment script writing, those things. So you can use that for that also. So GitHub is not for just for software engineers. It is also for DevOps engineers. It is also for component developers. So it is for companies also. Next question is from Suchetan Shravanan. He's asking, I am an electrical engineering student, second year. Where do I start to learn coding to fare well in IT placements? What should I do first? Which lecture should I follow? Where do I start? Can someone give me a roadmap? So first of all, you need to find out what do you want to become, like what are the options of completing electrical engineering. Like you just can't only become a coder. You don't need to learn, most of the time you don't need to learn coding to become an electrical engineer. Electrical engineer is completely different like line from coding. So you need to see that whether you want to go in coding or you want to become an electrical engineer and what are the options towards that. So find out what are the roles and responsibilities of an electrical engineer, what kind of things you would like to do in your career, in your life, what are your likes, what are your dislikes. So note down all these things, then think through it, then probably you will get a roadmap anyway. If you find out a goal that okay, yes, I want to become this or I want to do this thing, then of course you will get a roadmap. And regarding which lectures to attend, probably you need to attend all the lectures which is mentioned in your syllabus, because once if you don't attend those, you will your attendance will be short and you will not be able to even clear electrical engineering. So you need to attend all the lectures. But apart from the lectures, what all things you have to do, that probably you have to decide based on what is your goal. Next question is from Manish Rana. He's asking, what technology should one learn to stay ahead in the IT industry from now until 2029? Manish, if you have chosen an evergreen technology, then I don't think that it will die in just coming 9 years. So my suggestion would be, again, learn .NET and .NET based technologies, because .NET based technologies are ruling the enterprise world. So if you have to get a job, then of course you have to learn .NET based technologies. Yeah, enough of .NET promotion. But frankly speaking, instead of learning technologies, you should just learn whatever is there in your course. From your question, I'm assuming that you are a student. So first of all, you should complete whatever course you are doing, then probably join a company, and then whatever technology you have been assigned to or whatever project you are working on, learn from there that what is the roadmap of that project. For example, when I talk about .NET technologies, so there is a complete roadmap for .NET framework and what is coming in .NET framework in next, I think, 6-7 years. Till 2028, I guess. Yeah, so they have a roadmap till next 8 years that what they are going to add in .NET framework. So just pick that technology, follow the roadmap which they are following, and you will grow along with that. Because as I answered in one of the previous questions also, that learning is throughout the life. It's not like that you will learn one technology just now and you will sit silently and work in that technology till 2029. That is not going to happen. You have to continuously learn to grow. So pick any technology of your choice which is currently running well in market, and then keep on learning or keep on upskilling on that technology till 2029. Next question is from CP Kumar. He is asking, can you help me with below? Number one, is Birla Soft a product based company or a service based company? Number two, I heard it is both product based company and service based company. Is it true? Number 3, if I join as a SAP basis manager in Birlasoft, then for me is a product based company or a service based company? So CP Kumar, to answer your question, number 1, Birlasoft is mainly considered as a service based company. Some people say it as a product based company because most of the service based companies has their own products also, which they either use internally or they sell it to their clients in license model. Because I know many service based companies has their own products also. So to them I call them as a productized service company. So they are kind of a productized service company. So mainly Birlasoft is a service based company, but yes, it offers productized service also. Now coming to your third part, that is SAP based manager, will it be a product based or will it be a service based? Frankly speaking, you will be a SAP based manager. It doesn't matter whether it is a product based or service based. Company is treated on a whole. So on a whole, Birlasoft is a service based company. Next question is from Ricky Smith. He is asking, how do I get an entry level computer science job with no experience? Ricky, there are many fresher openings in most of the companies. Like recently on Twitter, I saw that Syncfusion is hiring fresher. So if you want to join Syncfusion, probably you can go on syncfusion.com and then you can apply as a fresher there. So many company hire freshers, many company hire interns also. There are many websites targeted only towards interns. So maybe you can look on those sites. There also you can get a fresher job or an intern job because you don't have any experience. So you will have to join as a fresher or intern in any company, which you can get from any job site or any intern targeting job site. For example, in India, it's Internshala is there, which is mainly for interns, for hiring interns. So you can join that company, create a profile on that site, and then from there you can apply for the company which are looking for interns or freshers. Next question is from Yash Yadav. He's asking, can bloggers get jobs in any company or in MNC with a degree or without a degree? Yash, if you are talking about bloggers like food bloggers or lifestyle bloggers, then probably they can't get a job. They are basically influencers. So they would be creating their websites or maintaining their blog sites. So they would be earning from affiliate marketing or all the other stuff by promoting some brand and all. So they can't directly join any MNC as an employee. Most of the MNC basically hire some experts of a particular technology. So maybe you can become an expert by writing blog also. So if you have a domain knowledge and if you are an expert, then of course you can be hired. So yes, it depends on what kind of blogger the person is. And now regarding degree or without degree, it basically depends on the kind of the job for which company is looking for. So they have a criteria that whether they need a degree person or they need a non-degree person. Sometimes if a blogger is a big influencer and he's also an expert, then companies most of the time they hire them without degree also. So it basically depends on the type of the blogger, his popularity. Nowadays, even people working in MNC are writing blogs. So it's vice versa. It happens. So these were my answers to your tech and career related queries in this episode of Techie Tuesdays. If you like my answers, then please subscribe to my channel and share this video with your friends, family and colleagues. If you want your questions to be featured in next episode of Techie Tuesdays, then DM me your question on any social media platform. All my social media handles are Techie Rathore. So until my next video, take care. Bye-bye.